His name is Lokhe Dube. He's from South Africa. He's also lit like Nelson Mandela. This is the True Breakfast Show. Don't forget, later on, journalists at the Capitol building where the National Board Authority will appear for public hearings. You know, this is a battle against corruption. Jeremy, we're going to be there later on this morning at 11 o'clock in the Joint Assembly Hall. My name is Mama D. Well, if you've been following our productions and the one of this week, that is on Monday, we've been doing series of shows and remembering and, the great man, Nelson Madiba Mandela, who passed last Thursday. It's been nice. We entertained many of you here. We had our guests commenting on it. Today, we're going to conclude the show on a rather historic note with a rare appearance of one of Liberia's, no doubt, arguably Liberia's most eloquent intellectual and person of age, Boima Fahnbulleh. I don't know how to refer to him, whether we call him a politician, a technocrat. We'll have the time to expand a little on that. Good morning, Dad, and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Momadi, thank you.
And you feel being here this morning. This is our first video interaction.
It's been such a long time, but it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to, of course, sit and talk to you whenever we can find the time.
And I must say, thank you for finding the time this morning to talk to us. Well, I want to play this. Perhaps you'll like this. That, actually, you remember this one?
Yes, very well.
From UB40?
Yes.
And I also like that I found this later on. They talk about our own song.
Yes, it's writing your own history, the people of South Africa, marching onto victory and making the history as they went along. So it is a very positive song. The artists of South Africa were very conscious of the role they had to play in stimulating the people and giving them a sense of how culture was a factor in molding the revolutionary minds of the people. Yes, this one by UB40, it's very, very exciting at the time. Here were people who had come together, blacks and whites, in UB40, and they were talking about the struggle in South Africa, calling on the people not to stop, shouting Amadla Kawetu. And for us those days, it was thrilling. It was not only talking about romance or so, but people who were talking about very serious things, artists who were talking about serious, serious politics in the world.
Good. I don't know whether you will know this, won't you? Okay, I'm getting you before the state honor that one, so let me say it better. I see you shaking your head.
Yes, I remember the courageous people of Guinea under the banner of the PDG, Parti Democratique de Guinée, and of course being led in the vanguard of one of the most remarkable African revolutionaries, Ahmed Sékou Touré. And of course I remember as a young student at Fulbright College when the Portuguese colonialists invaded Guinea, and of course Ahmed Sékou Touré was missing for a few hours. Nkrumah was then in exile in Guinea, and Ahmed Sékou Touré had told him to find shelter in one of the friendly embassies. And of course, the Portuguese mercenaries and the agents had taken over most parts of the country. And after about 2-3 hours, the song came on the air, the people of Guinea tuned to the radio and listened to Sekou Touré calling on them to defend the motherland. And you had old men, young student radicals from the university, taking the AK for the survey, women putting the babies on their backs and going out in the field to confront the Portuguese colonialists. And in November 1970, that was a very decisive period in the African revolutionary struggle. The Portuguese were crushed decisively by the people of Guinea, the armed people of Guinea. It was fantastic.
Okay, we're going to talk more about that, more about the fight for freedom, the fight to protect the motherland, the rest of it. But I must ask this question as a basis to move forward. Are you a politician or a technocrat?
Just a simple Liberian who tries to do his work and tries to be honest to his conviction. The technocrat, no. Intellectual, no. I'm a student, still studying. I try to read. If you want to say I'm a simple man who likes to study.
Revolutionary?
Well, I hope that I can develop the qualities as I grow older to be called a revolutionary. You know, revolutionaries are the highest species of the humankind. Men who are selfless, who dedicate their life to noble causes, and they are ready to pay supreme sacrifices for whatever. So probably I'm trying to get there. I will be humble enough to say, when I get to the point of being considered a revolutionary, that will be done by the cadres and militants who appreciate the little we have done, and also those who will write the history. But I will not call myself intellectual. That would be a little bit presumptuous. Just say
that you're trying to be a very humble man, but you're intellectual by whole standard and definition of the world.
No. You see,
you've read politics, you've read philosophy, you've come a long way in Liberian history.
Yes. But the reading and getting the doctorate degree, that was simply to please my parents. I've always been an activist. I've always been somebody who stood in the forefront of noble causes, of causes which, of course, benefit the masses of the people. In terms of being one who sits in an ivory tower and play with ideas, no, that is not my calling. I'm somebody who works, and I like to work in the front line, especially in causes that I believe are noble. So that is as simple as that. You see, we have a problem with people trying to promote themselves as intellectuals. The culture has developed in a society where people buy degrees nowadays. People come back from Europe and America with fake documents, and they claim to be intellectuals. You see, but that is immaterial to the masses of people who are struggling for their daily existence. If you have a PhD, you are very smart, then good for you. But to put it, to wear it on your shoulder, and we've said from time immemorial, that a degree, a certificate which is not put at the service of the people, is completely useless.
On the wall.
Yeah, we said that years ago as a young man. We still believe that your education, your degree, must be put at the service of the people.
Now look at ideology. Where can we place you? Can we compare you to, for example, Mualimu or Nelson Mandela?
No.
In theory?
No.
Did they believe in the love of country and you do?
Oh yeah, well, certainly. So they're great. They're personalities who were produced by great people. You see, I said quite recently, Mandela's life is a reflection of the greatness of his people.
Okay.
A great people will always produce personalities like Mandela, Madiba, like Walter Sisulu, like Govan Mbeki, like Steve Biko, Winnie Mandela, Joe Slovo, a great people.
Are we not great people producing people like you? Liberians.
Well, you see, were you to listen to the kind of reflection of the young people in this country, one gets the feeling that there's so much work to be done. Yes, our militants and cadres are quite conscious. And this is why we like to deal with conscious brothers, who we call militants. And we are very happy and proud that these brothers have not given up. You come from years in exile, and what do you realize? After the brutality, after the bankruptcy, after the wars, when the people's children were being slaughtered and student militants were being massacred, and we can name so many of them. And yet you have young people in the country who still have the fire in the guts to say, this is wrong. And let me tell you something, many people comment on Madiba, Nelson Mandela. I remember in 2008, on his 90th birthday, 90 birthday, he said to the young people in South Africa, you must never give up the struggle for social justice. This is a 90-year-old man talking to the young people, do not, and this is the essence of the struggle, that it is based on the quest for social justice. The people must be treated right. They are human beings. They must live like human beings.
Okay.
We must not marginalize them, okay, because they and only they are the makers of history.
All right, I'll try to expand a little bit on your ideology and philosophy and where you stand. You use the word cadre, C-A-D-R-E. Right. You use the word militant. Right. Those are words associated with socialism?
No, no.
Or the fight for Africa, fight for freedom?
They are associated with, of course, the conscious effort of people to change the history in a positive direction. The cadres, if you like, the cadres, the militants, are the most conscious, and many of them are in the vanguard. You know, the late Thomas Sankara, of glorious memory,
of Burkina Faso,
yes, said this, he was a military man. He said, a soldier without political consciousness is a potential bandit.
Dangerous.
Very dangerous. So even a politician without consciousness is a potential thief, is a potential robber, because he feels politics or public service is simply meant to enrich himself, is entitlement. So the militants are those who have a high level of understanding of the necessity of the historical march. That's what makes them militants. Not because they, you see, these ideologies are usually ascribed to African people by those who have their own objective.
Agenda, objective.
In order to pin certain people as demons, others are good, simply because the level of consciousness of our people is very low.
Are you referring to the West?
It's not only the West. It's like you have people in the East, as a matter of fact, you know, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, there were African students who were massacred. And these are people who had lived under socialism for 70 years. There are countries in the East, in Asia, where Africans are booed. There's a lack of consciousness. It's not only the West. I mean, in the West, we have people who are backward, who are reactionaries. We also have people who are positive, who are very forthright in the struggle for human dignity. So it doesn't matter where the people come from. It's the same with the race issue. It doesn't matter what color a man's skin is, how he thinks, his consciousness. And when you look at that in the African context, you begin to understand that it doesn't matter the man's tribe. It depends on how he thinks, his thought. You see, because these factors, the thought, the consciousness, the way he promotes himself, his attitude, these are factors which allow him to be honest, to be honest with himself, to follow the conviction of his conscience. This is important, extremely important.
Very important. We'll stay with Warren. Later on, we'll go to the main point for which we invited you here to talk about Madiba, his philosophy, his ideology, and his contribution to the fight for South Africa. Africa, we have political emancipation. What next?
Well, that was always the itinerary. After political independence, after we have hoisted the flags, the next stage of the struggle, which is the most important, the most dynamic, is economic independence, economic liberation. And you can't do that with a social class. You have to do that with the masses of the people. The people involved in self-reliance, in developing the agricultural base, in engaging in production, the people and only the people can defend whatever gains you make. You know, you had independence in Africa. You got national anthems. But look at the condition of the African masses in some countries after 50 years. Look at the condition of the people after 165 years. Even our own country, How can you develop human beings when they live in some place called West Point or New Bhutan Borough? Where is the culture? Where is the culture? Go in the rural areas. I traveled in the southeast. This was about 3-4 months ago. I came back and I said to people I work with, I'm depressed. And I don't usually get depressed. I am an optimist. I traveled some places in the southeast where the people still live like they're living in the Middle Ages. They are so far from modern day transformation. They don't even understand what is happening in Monrovia. The children, what future for these children, you say to yourself. And that is a struggle. You can have political independence, you can celebrate your independence, but if your people do not have economic power to be able to provide for themselves, then you remain a beggar nation. Your dignity is questioned, because if you keep on begging and accepting aid when you have resources in your country, then those you go to beg, they either think that psychologically there's something wrong with you, or you probably just willingly accept the status of slaves.
Dr. Fahnbulleh, this is the point. Everyone agreed that Africa is a very wealthy continent. We have all the resources. Economy shouldn't be our problem. Do we have leadership problem in Africa?
Oh, very much so. There's a leadership deficit. I mean, you know, whether we believe that or not, the Bible, which of course many people believe in, it says it's a book of wisdom. Where there's no vision, the people will perish. It's so obvious that Africa has suffered from leadership deficit for a very long time. Even after the struggle for the emancipation of Africa, we produced few men like Kwame Nkrumah, Malimu Julius Nyerere, Patrick Lumumba, and you read these people and you have an understanding that these were men who had come with a broad vision of what Africa needed. Unfortunately, they were either overthrown or things were very difficult in terms of not being able to mobilize the people speedily enough. So yes, I would be the first to admit, and we had a series of military coups, that we have suffered seriously in Africa.
You just named great men of Africa, including Kwame Nkrumah. Mm-hmm. How come they failed or they didn't impact and the consciousness of the African men to economic self-governance?
No, it depends on who you listen to. It depends on which books you read. Did they fail? Did Nkrumah fail? Quite recently, the BBC carried out a survey. They wanted to find the most remarkable African of the 20th century. The people voted overwhelmingly for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah because his vision, this is a young man who came from abroad, became the leader of Ghana, who understood that the independence of Ghana was meaningless if it was not linked up with the total liberation of Africa. He felt that Africa had to achieve its independence, throw off the shackle of dependency, and then begin to build an economic base. What did he start to do in Ghana? He wanted to electrify this whole country. He built the Akusumo Dam. He realized that to attract industries, you needed electrical power. He's concentrated on infrastructure. Today in Ghana, you go to the remotest part of Ghana, you can see the impact of Nkrumah's work. But then, you have to look at the context in which Nkrumah operated. Don't forget, this was the only African leader who had a deep understanding that the struggle in Congo, and the assassination of Lumumba was tied in with the total liberation of Southern Africa. He was right. If you read his book, Challenge of the Congo, is the beautiful analysis of foreign forces trying to derail this process of African liberation and then economic emancipation.
They were talking about political emancipation, self-governance, but did they go beyond that?
Oh yes.
That was my point, you know, because we got the independence, what's next?
But I gave you the example of Nkrumah. I gave you the question of the Akusumo Dam. How do you go about industrializing your country? Like the example of Nyerere in Tanzania, the Arusha Declaration, the stress on self-reliance, yes, the building of the rural communities, the, if you like, the education of the people to understand, first and foremost, they had a very rich history, they could produce as much as any people, and they were not inferior to any race. This was very, very crucial. It was a stage of political conscientization, which I can say to you, you find lacking in many African countries. So yes, people are now looking at the Asian tigers. They look at China, they look at South Korea, they look at Thailand, they look at Singapore. But look at the people who devised the economic transformation of those countries. In China, the Mao Zedong, Chiu Enlai, in Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew. I mean, all these men were great thinkers. And they realized that education was necessary before you even talk about industrialization. They realized that you have to provide health care for your people. You have to provide housing. You have to put emphasis on education. And after that, you begin to attract foreign investors. So when they come to your country, they meet your people prepared, prepared to work with them instead of importing foreign workers. So that has always been the nature of the struggle in Africa. It's not that we don't have the resources. It's not that we don't have talent. Look at some of the young men who come from very, very poor backgrounds, who grew up in slums. Listen to them talk. See how much they work. If you were to put them in any first-class university, they will excel. What is lacking in Africa are the opportunities. The people are not stupid. They are not lazy. They have survived for centuries just working the land. You have to now provide the ingredients for these people to at least build up the environment and make sure that they have some form of sustenance. It's interesting.
We've done that for over 50 years since independence, since the 60s. We've been doing that, we've been on the farm. But Africa still remains economically backward.
Exactly, yes, but of course Africa, you see, sometimes you have to think outside the box. The question we ask, have we adopted the correct economic model for economic transformation? Have we? You see, because if you were to say you want to go on the trajectory of building a capitalist base, etc., etc., most countries in Africa may take another 200 years just to get to the level of a middle-income country.
Why?
Just simply because the ingredients which made it possible for Europe to industrialize, for the West to embark on this capitalist venture, these ingredients are lacking. You in Africa, you cannot possess colonies to have captive markets and get resources. You cannot. You in Africa, you are mainly an agrarian people. So
making use of the soil.
You have to turn to the soil. And that is not capitalism. That is not. So what model are we talking about? Are we talking about a developmental state, which some people refer to as socialism? The developmental state. I give you a good example. After the Second World War, there was an attempt to transform Europe. You had something called the Marshall Plan, where the public injected so much capital into reconstruction, into public projects, and they employed so many people. And as a result, it was the public sector which fueled the economic transformation and allowed the private sector to develop. In Africa, do we want to go the way of allowing the private sector to just to push the agenda for transformation? Can the private sector do it? Can it? Or we must have a combination of the public sector, the developmental state, and a minor role for the public private sector until we are strong enough to allow our people to get involved in economic activities. In Ghana, you know, under the PNDC, the Ghanaian government came up with an investment code where retail trade was
exclusively reserved for
Ghanaians. It was reserved for Ghanaians. Any other person who wanted to come in terms of wholesale trade and other investment, they have to give 49% to Ghanaians. Now, Liberians, we must get into that too. We have to build a middle class which invests first and foremost in its own country, which creates employment opportunities. So our people must be involved in all sectors of the economy, whether in the oil industry when it starts, whether in the plantation. Liberians ought to occupy a massive chunk of our economy. This is the only way we can go forward. We're not going to go to other people's country and remain as cleaners and sweepers. No, this is your country. The resources are here. When you invest, you employ your people, then you have a greater stake within the system. You have a stake within the system because you have built a country. They are Liberian business people. Mm-hmm. They can do it. So in terms of the economic empowerment of our people, it is something that we have to demand.
Okay, we have all the good ideas. Why are we still the way we are as a continent?
Oh, well, you know, Africa has not been, has not been a quiet place. We have had military coups. You talked about the leadership question, the leadership deficit. You had military coups in Africa. This continent has the tragedy of turning out some of the greatest buffoons who were political leaders. Where are you talking about John Bidel Bukasa, who made himself an emperor? You're talking about the other gendarme, Obutu Sese Seko. You produce these people who had no idea except that they were gendarmes of foreign interests. Okay? And so Africa has been struggling. The fact that we sit here and discuss South Africa simply means that we have now completed the first stage of our liberation. We were colonists. We came from colonialism. We were underdeveloped. Our leaders, some of our best leaders, were massacred. Look at the case of Lumumba, a young man in his 30s.
Sam Juma, including?
Yes, Sam Juma, yes. Juma is all right. Eduardo Mulani,
Gamal Nasser.
Yes. Gamal Abdel Nasser, Amika Kabra, some of our finest sons, some of our most decent and remarkable soldiers were slaughtered. So this has not been the struggle where Africa has sat passively with its hands folded. Hmm. The enemies of Africa, no matter who they are, understand the potential of this continent, and they will make sure that in order to grab Africa's resources, they would have to look for people who they feel are their allies. Hmm. Granted, there's nothing wrong with that. But we on our own have to then train our militants, our cadres, to understand the essence of the struggle. And they must be prepared to move to the vanguard.
You're talking about conscientization.
Very much so. You're talking about just political education. Political education. If you ask in this country, my brother, how many people have read and understood E.W. Blyden? How many people have taken the time to study the writings of Edwin J. Barclay, who is the president? Okay? You find this quantity of knowledge will be frightening. But you have to know what people went through in this country. Even within the oligarchy, you had people who were very conscious, eh? Mm-hmm. People who were very conscious, who said, we have to now unite our people in order to build a new society. You know, I listened to some political dinosaurs the other day at the memorial for Madiba, mm-hmm. saying that, well, you see, Tolbert came and he opened up, and that's where we had all the crises. And I said, this man has been reading his history books upside down. You really think in history, leaders can decide to change, to hold people down if the people are conscious and they're ready to move, then you still don't understand what happened in South Africa. Because let me just zero in on South Africa. And this is what I say to people. Okay. Our appreciation to the people of South Africa is unquestionable.
Okay, we'll come to South Africa. Let me conclude with this final question. This is very important. You outlined the goods. Why does Africa stay the same? Do we have the West imposing some economic policies and program laws to keep us this way? For example, the World Bank, the IMF, they decide how you use your money as African. They tell you where to put your money. Is this a new form or new strategy to keep Africa economically unstable? No. That's a perfect word.
No. I think, I think some of them mean well. But that's within the limits. That's all they know. Those are the theories they grew up with. Those are the theories they learn in the universities. If they're using Africa as Africans are experimental guinea pigs, they believe that. They believe the theories are right. Are you following me? Hmm. The problem here is that the world situation has changed. It is no more the World Bank and the IMF. You have options. You can turn to countries who have money. You can barter your resources. You can say to a particular country, look, I got rubber, I got iron ore, I got this. I can give you X percent of these things, but I need 15 schools, training institutions for teachers and doctors. I want roads covering the entire country. You know, and you don't have to sit and get money. The resources will be your bargaining chips, your resources. So the world situation has changed. From the end of the Second World War, where African countries had very limited options, and they went to the IMF and the World Bank, with the new economic situation, there are so many possibilities. There are so many of getting resources to transform your country. It does. You see, we as black people must not condemn those who are convinced of what they are doing. You see, for me and you, that belief is mistaken, because we suffer the pains of these experiments. But for those people, they believe. They believe it's justified. So we have to tell our people that we must shift, we must have a paradigm shift in terms of our economic formula for transformation. It is our responsibility. Why did you go to school? You sat in school in Europe and America with some of these very people who are at the World Bank and the IMF. You were smart enough to beat them in class. And before we go on with this, let me tell you a story. There was a professor in Kenya who had gone to England to do some research, and he went to Oxford University, this is first-class university in England. He had taught these kids in class. He returned to Kenya, and they said there was an expert coming to talk about economic transformation from Britain. And so he decided to go to his program. He said when he got there, he saw this girl, discussing, and she was the so-called expert. And so he waited. When there was an interval, he went to her. Are you Susan Matthews? She said, yes, how do you know? He said, but you are my student at Oxford. The student of this Kenyan professor had now become an expert in African economy and had come to lecture this professor and his colleagues who were far more experienced, far more educated. Here's an example.
What's the point?
The point there is that we allow people that we are smarter than, then we allow people who are our inferiors in terms of even analysis to come back and call themselves consultants and experts. And we accept what they proffer, what they offer. You know Africa better, but you sit with these people and say your theories are all wrong. They cannot fit us, they cannot help us to develop. We have to develop a level of understanding, because you see, this comes from our inferiority, that anything that comes from certain quarters is right, it's good. Even if we know, it's garbage and it won't benefit our people. So the options are there for us. And we as African people have to continue to discuss these options at all levels. And so we must not hesitate. You sit in an office, somebody comes and says, I'm from the World Bank. I got a PhD, I'm an expert. And what do you know of Africa? How do you understand Africa? They're done. So you sit in the capital city, Monrovia, Freetown, Accra, Harare, Nairobi, and you put out position papers. You don't even travel 5 miles in the countryside to see how the people live or what to do. This is the problem.
Okay, wonderful. His name is Dr. H. Boima Fahnbulleh. We're going to our main discussion that has to do with Madiba. Is Mandela regarded as a pop star? Is he a celebrity or a freedom fighter?
Nah, you see, again, this is where you come with consciousness. We must always choose our heroes. Mandela was a simple soldier of the South African people. He was a commandante. And because these people were such a great people, so conscious, when Mandela was buried for 27 years
in prison,
these people did not stop.
You call it buried?
Oh yes, of course. Anybody who puts you in prison for 27 years, you come out, want to see the sun, you walk in the quarry. You sleep on the floor. You are banned. People cannot listen to you. People cannot talk to you. Your writings cannot be about. No. Mandela and his colleagues were buried alive. But because they had such great people, others came forward. You see, the story of Mandela and his wife Winnie is a tragic love story, and probably that's why the Mandela phenomenon is so fascinating for people. Yeah, was a young activist.
You think it shouldn't be fascinating?
Pardon?
You think it shouldn't be fascinating?
Oh, that's what I'm coming to say to you. Okay. Why it's fascinating, and some people tend to dwell on it so much, excluding the heroism and courage of the South African people, which is very dangerous, you see, because we who understand the process a bit, we do not subscribe to the cult of the personality. It's dangerous for a people. When you deify somebody to an extent where you don't see any forward movement in the absence of that person, it's dangerous for you, because Mandela himself said, history is not made by kings, leaders, princes, but by the masses of people, the ordinary workers and peasants. That was Mandela. Ye was a young man, a lawyer. He had started his law firm in 1951 with Oliver Tambo, who indeed was the founder of the ANC. This man, most people don't realize, was expelled from school as a young man, moved to Johannesburg. He had divorced his first wife, Evelyn Massey. He met Winnie Mandela. They got married, but he was very active. In 1955, they had the Congress of the People in Soweto, where they came out with the charter, the Freedom Charter. And the Freedom Charter says one thing: we are fighting for a non-racial South Africa, where all races will be equal and have access to all the resources of this country. This man was arrested at a very young age. He left behind him a beautiful wife with two daughters. For the length of time he spent in prison with Susulu, you know, Ahmed Kadrata and others, this woman, this noble African woman, never gave up.
That's true.
She was unbound, she was in prison, she was harassed, and the picture we saw growing up was of this beautiful and charming black woman with one child in her arm and the other daughter holding on to her skirt. And this woman had her face thrust in the air, shouting Amandla Kawete. It was a picture of romance, of whether this beautiful person will continue the fight that this man started. That's one. Number two, whether this woman who had two daughters who sacrificed all the happiness of a mother to join her people for liberation. And she continued. She never, each time people mentioned Mandela while he was in prison, they referred to Mandela. They referred to this woman. And even in his absence, and the absence of other leaders of the ANC, new forces emerge. Steve Biko and the Black Consciousness Movement. The fight, the struggle of the students of Soweto, the massacre of over 600 students by the South African Security Services, that was done because the students had read Mbeki, who had said to them, we must not allow our African identity to be submerged or crushed by anybody. We must refuse to be lectured in Afrikaans. And that was Biko. He paid a heavy price. He was massacred. He was killed at the age of 30. This great son of Africa. There were young men in South Africa who went to the gallows because of the political activism. They sentenced them to death. These young men went to the gallows singing freedom songs. Many of them. So you see,
what are you trying to paint? You're trying to say that we should elevate the relevance of the people rather than Mandela as a person?
Exactly. You see, because...
But you're talking about vision. Look at the Bible. When there is no vision, the people perish.
When is
the, there should be the bearer on the vision.
No, the vision, not necessarily. The vision, you see, the vision doesn't come from an individual. That's the danger. Let me come back to Black Africa. Do you wonder how the farmers...
The peasant
planned the crops? And They know more about weather pattern than most people who study geography. Do you wonder how the mothers in the rural areas deliver the children? In the urban centers, women go to deliver, they spend 3-4 days in hospitals. The mothers in the countryside, they leave the farm to deliver, they go back to the farm. Have you wondered how the people in the rural area combat malaria? Have you wondered how they fight diseases? It's because these people have the experience of the forefathers. They have vision. How do we live? How do we survive? When the leader comes, what he does is to take that vision of the people and say, it is positive. And I feel that you understand that I have seen it too, and so we must move together. It is not an individual. You see, this is the thinking of the oppressors. This is the thinking of those who dominate people. If the people take one individual and elevate him to the rank of a god, all they have to do, put him in jail, eliminate him, and then the people are stagnant. But when the people develop the consciousness, they move forward like they did in South Africa. Wave out without Mandela. Wave out without Oliver Tambo. Wave out without Walter Sisulu. Wave out without Governor Mbeki. The people kept marching to victory. And this was the beauty. This was the beauty. The victory in South Africa was the people's victory. Mm-hmm. They honor Mandela because they felt that he remained true to his conviction as expressed in the Freedom Charter. His famous saying at the Rivonian tribe, I have fought against white domination as well as black domination. I have lived to the ideal of a non-racial egalitarian society. This is an ideal I wish to achieve in my lifetime. But if needs be, it is an ideal for which I'm prepared to die.
Are you trying to indicate that with or without Mandela, South Africa will have gained its independence?
Of course. And with our anybody. Mandela was in prison for 27 years. Who were the people? As a matter of fact, as a young man, he was head of in Contour, Switzerland, the armed wing, arrested in 1961, sentenced to life imprisonment with, of course, Ahmed Kadata and others, Walter Sisulu. Nothing stopped. The armed wing of the ANC, which was banned, recruited people. They trained them in Mozambique, in of course in Zimbabwe, in Angola. After the Soweto uprising, with the killing of 600 students, over 14,000 young students crossed the border to go for military training. They came back into South Africa and formed what they call the Young Comrades. These were the people who were mobilizing the masses of the South African people.
So in short, Mandela is the reflection of the greatness of the South African people.
That every historical personality who has played a role in history as Mandela has to be a reflection of the greatness of a people. This is the only way we understand history. This is the way we understand history. Others understand history differently. They think of a great leader, they think of an iconic figure. And when this individual is removed, then the people slumber. That is the hero theory of history. And it's merely believed by people who feel that, who feel like policemen, that the people do not think. They are like sheep. So they follow somebody. They fight for somebody to make somebody leader. All you have to do is eliminate that person and they go back to sleep. That is anti-people. That is a very backward way of looking at human history. And like Mandela said, he was very right. The people make history. Organize and mobilize, they can transform the lives and transform society.
What do you think we remember Mandela for?
I can think of three which show the brilliance, the decency of this noble soldier. One, this was a very simple man, a very, very humble man, like all true revolutionaries, very humble.
Arrogance is not a quality.
Oh no, arrogance are for those who understand nothing about history. Arrogance are for those who have a misplaced sense of their own worth. You see, when you work with the people and you understand what they are capable of doing, you cannot be arrogant. Who feed us every day? Just look at Morovia. We eat our palm butter of the south. Who feed us? You feed us. You go to Douala market. Our mothers.
The pigs.
They are sitting there selling the produce. They go to the farms and bring the stuff. Are you following me? The people feed us. Who clean our houses? Who drive our taxis? These people need to be mobilized. And that is why the sons and daughters who go to higher institutions must never forget the root. The root. Mandela, let Lumumba, let others, great African revolutionaries, as sons of a people. And what is so fantastic about Mandela, that this man never forgot his roots. He never forgot that these people have paid such a great price. When the struggle intensified in Southern Africa, the Cubans in Angola, the defeat of the South African army at Quito Carnival, the emergence of Frelimo, the independence of Zimbabwe, when the dynamics of the region changed.
You're going to the fall of the apartheid system.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
I come to the 3 point.
Okay.
When the South Africans realized they were losing, in 1985 they offered to free Mandela if he could only renounce violence. Mandela refused. This shows you a man of conviction. Oh, you want to release me now because you are being defeated by the combined forces of these conscious African people? I will stay in prison. That's one. The second.
That is consistency.
Yes.
Okay.
In principle. The second thing about this noble man, was that he was touched. He was touched by the suffering. Well, just not the South African people, but all African people. He was touched. And you see, when you have a decent conscience, you are touched by the misery of ordinary people. Mandela said, where there is poverty, there cannot be true freedom. Where there is poverty, there cannot be true freedom.
Expand on that.
Pardon?
Expand on that. Where there is poverty, there cannot be true freedom. That a poor man cannot be a free man?
A poor man who suffers for daily bread, does he have the luxury of reflecting on development? He wants to survive. As a matter of fact, look at Africa. You say you are voting. When the people are destitute, they are poor, they sell the votes. There's no dignity. So Mandela, yes, where there's poverty, and dire poverty as you have in some African countries, the people are not free. Justice is for sale. You know that. That's the third, and most, for me, the most important. Mandela was loyal to his friends and comrades to the end. When he became president of South Africa, and he embraced, of course, Fidel Castro, he embraced some of the leaders who were not friends of certain people, they condemned Mandela. Mandela said, I know my friends. I know the friends of my people. I will not break a relationship with those who sacrificed so much for our liberation. He was true to his friends. How many people remain true to brothers with whom they struggled yesterday? How many people, after they have ascended to power, embrace those who gave the best of their lives to ensure victory? How many? And this was the these were the hallmarks of a decent mind. So no, he was not a fashion icon. He was not a film star. He was not a pop star. He was a soldier. He was a revolutionary. And many people are choked. They're choked. They don't want to say something which is very important to the African people. Mandela was a member of the South African Communist Party, the SACP. When he was arrested, he was a member of the Central Committee. The alliance.
And they were all part of the Freedom Charter.
Yes. The alliance which pushed the struggle was an alliance of the ANC, COSATU, the Congress of South African Trade Unions, and the SACP. So, as a matter of fact, he was banned under the Suppression of Communism Act.
Okay.
This, the people who kept saying to us that we tell you who your friends must be, have not been fair to us. Because African people, we have our intelligence. God has given us our own intelligence. Mm-hmm. to decide what is in our interest. We decide our friends. You don't choose our friends for us. So Ye was a man who did not listen to people who said, do not deal with the South African communists. Do not deal with the likes of Joe Slovo Rufus. He said, but we've struggled together. And this man was loyal to the end to his friends.
But now you agree that several of the persons, you named several of them who participated in the fight for freedom. And specifically, I remember the name is very highlighted, Sisulu. He spent 25 years in jail by Mandela.
What?
But how come Mandela's name is the biggest?
But I said to you,
he joined the ANC. No. He did not form the ANC.
No, it was formed by Oliver Tambo. It was formed by Oliver Tambo. This is...
But his name is not synonymous to the ANC.
Oh yes, Tambo for a long time. Which history have you been reading, my brother? Tambo was the one in exile. Everybody knew Tambo. Unfortunately, he died. The international airport is Oliver Tambo Airport in South Africa, in the respect of Johannesburg, this great man. But let me say something. And this is what I said. The Mandela story is a tragic romance story. 27 years in prison, a beautiful wife, conscious sister, Winnie Mandela, Madikizela Mandela, she never stopped agitating for this man. She never stopped holding high the banner of resistance. And many South Africans, you see, it was a matter of conscience. If this woman, whose husband is in prison, can come out with her two little daughters and keep shouting to us, Marge, Marge, who are we to stop? So you see, you had Albertinans, Sisulu and others, yes, but Winnie played a very good role. That is why, we must study enough not to allow the enemies of our people's progress to choose heroes for us. They want to degrade Winnie Mandela, yes. There's a Mandela divorce in 1998. The problem is, this personal problem. When Madiba came from prison after 27 years, this woman was no more a housewife. She was a revolutionary who had endured torture, banishment, imprisonment. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
So she could not play the role of a housewife. She had fought to the extent where she was now a commandante. And one has to respect her for that. Okay? So yes. Mandela was fortunate, a strong fighter in prison, enduring the dampness of a prison cell, outside, a beautiful wife.
For 27 years.
27 years. A beautiful wife like Joan of Arc, taking the flag forward. And that was the beauty. That was the beauty. And another thing you can say about the South African brothers, they were all great revolutionaries and self-effacing. They never fought for power. They were not like that. They were in prison. They realized they would probably die together. But they were not struggling to be presidents of South Africa. They felt they were sacrificial lambs. And the people were making them to understand that even if you die, new leaders will emerge who understand the struggle. And that was the beauty. And so they all came out of prison. Look at Governor Mbeki, the old man. His son was recognized and pushed forward to take over after Mandela because of his father. The role of the old man Governor Mbeki in the history of South Africa. So these were not ordinary, if you like, these were not ordinary politicians. They were never. Politicians do that. They make compromises. You know, they talk big, they have contempt for the people. Elections, they go there, they roll up the sleeve, you see them lifting up babies, they are politicians. You see, revolutionaries are different, they're different. They believe in the conviction.
Of the struggle.
Yes, and if they say they dedicate their lives to a struggle, for them, it becomes a religion. The struggle to emancipate the people and to bring them into the centerfold of history. That is the mission. And for me, I'm quite satisfied as we reflect on the life of this man. I see in our own country, young men who have not given up the vision of a society of equality, of a society of dignity. We have participated a bit in the history of this country. But the history will extend for the next 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. This history of this nation will extend to the next 1,000 years. And the younger generation must understand what needs to be done to build a unified society, a society of justice and equality.
Okay. Back to South Africa. You used the word ban several times, whether four times. Was there legislation?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. No.
What was it? Tell me about ban.
Oh, Mamadi Diakata, you are banned under the Suppression of Communism Act. That means you cannot be seen with more than one person. You cannot speak in public. You cannot write for people to read. You are a non-person. Oh yes, Mandela was banned in 1960. The ANC was banned in 1961. The ban was not lifted until Mandela came from prison in 1990. So they banned people. They sent you to the remotest part of South Africa. You became a non-person. They did that to Winnie Mandela and other fighters. Those they didn't put in prison and kill, they banned them. And then later they will unban them. You see? So it was the nature of the system.
Okay, if Mandela had accepted negotiation with apartheid to come out, what would happen to him?
If he had accepted?
Yeah.
Oh, history had gone forward so fast, and Mandela is a student of history. He's a smart, he was a smart man. After the children of Soweto had paid the supreme sacrifice, 600 of them massacred, after thousands of young brothers and sisters were crossing the border, after the MPLA had taken power in Angola, Mozambique, Frelimo, after Mugabe and ZANU had taken power, there was transformation in Southern Africa.
Okay, let's talk about the fall of apartheid. What led to the crumbling of apartheid and the release of Nelson Mandela from prison?
Oh, international pressure, the battle in the region, for instance, you know, the freedom fighters were struggling because you had countries which were still under the Portuguese. And then in 1975, there was a major development in Portugal. 1974, something they refer to as the Carnation Revolution, where young Portuguese soldiers who had gone to fight in Guinea-Bissau, in Angola, in Mozambique, had read some of the literatures of the freedom fighters. They had gone back to Portugal and they realized the dictatorship of Salazar and Cardenal were backward. Portugal was the most underdeveloped European country at that time, with huge empires. They overthrew that government and said to the African freedom fighters,
"We'll join.
You can have your independence. You can have your independence." So the Portuguese set up in Angola, they avoid a court where there will be power sharing. The South Africans refused. And so what they did, they started supporting other liberation movements. When these other liberation movements were not achieving their objectives, the South African invaded. In 1978, the South Africans came up with Operation Reindeer, where they move into Southern Angola, slaughter over 1,000 SWAPO fighters, wounded 4,000. In 1983, they had Operation Askari. They went back into Angola. But at the same time, history was moving against them. Frelimo emerged, providing guerrilla bases for the fighters of Southern Africa. Zimbabwe, Angola with the Cubans. And then that major battle, that historic battle, which was the greatest battle on the African continent since the Second World War, the Battle of Cuito Caneval, when the South Africans were beaten by the combined forces of the Angolan army, SWAPO guerrillas,
Frelimo.
They were beaten, and Cuban planes were flying over Namibia. SWAPO guerrillas were rejoicing in the slums of South Africa. The people were shouting, "They are coming, they are coming." And the South African had to sue because they did not want a struggle that would end with guerrilla fighters entering the various cities. So they sued for peace to save the neck. You really think they wanted to give independence, they wanted to get Mandela out of prison? They were forced by the regional reality. And this is why we have to always understand the dynamics. Our freedom fighters, whether they were in Namibia and Angola, they paid the price, and they forced the apartheid regime. Don't forget, there was a man called Ian Smith mm-hmm. in Rhodesia, okay. who declared unilateral independence, UDI. He said there will not be black majority rule in Rhodesia for 1,000 years. The developments in the region, the solidarity of Africa, forced this man to realize that he had to have some insurance, because victory was on the side of the African people. And this must also lead to us giving credit to the OAU. Because you see, if the South Africans had taken over Angola, probably South Africa would still be fighting for liberation. But when they went to the OAU in 1975 to decide whether Angola must be a member of the OAU and must be accepted, 22 African countries said, no, we don't want what is happening in Angola. We cannot recognize the government. 22 led by Tanzania us, we will accept the MPLA. There was a young man who had come to power in Nigeria called Murtala Mohammed. His famous speech, Africa Has Come of Age, was that we as African people, we endorse the MPLA. We understand why they are fighting. And we think that the decisive struggle taking place in the region will lead to the total liberation of Africa. Nigeria became a member of the frontline state. So I'm saying here that African people were contributed. Visionary fighters in Africa understood what was at stake in Angola. And so today, we as African people, we can now say we have passed the stage of being liberated people. Black people in South Africa can go any place. There are no more signs saying black whites only, blacks and dogs. No, we have passed that stage. What is on the agenda of our history is the economic emancipation of our people. There.
And that's the biggest fight.
That is the greatest fight. And that's why our people must be very strong. And to all our young militants and cadres, we say, courage, courage. You will get there. You will get there. I mean, we can see the writings on the wall. You have not given up. Mm-hmm. And this is positive.
And it will get better one day.
The people will make it better. Because the people deserve nothing than the best because of the sacrifices.
Let's talk about Liberia rule.
Well, Liberia rule, you know, people. You know, when somebody who's a great soldier died, a lot of people come to walk behind his coffin. They give themselves credit. We know more about the role of Liberia in the liberation struggle. I mean, you know, I listened to somebody saying, you know, Liberia took South Africa to the international court, Liberia and Ethiopia. And he misinformed our people by saying the South African ambassador said, but your constitution is racist because whites cannot be citizens. That was not the case. He was misinterpreted. The South African ambassador said, Liberia, you don't have the moral authority to condemn apartheid.
You were doing the same thing.
The young student said that the other day. The South African ambassador said, Mr. Representative of Liberia, you don't have the moral authority to stand here and condemn apartheid, because in your country, the masses of the people are discriminated against. They have to change their names to even be accepted.
And that was the reality?
Of course that was the reality. What, you want to sweep that on the carpet?
We're going to call that the Liberian version of apartheid?
Of course. There's the brother, the late Cyrenius IV, peace be to his ashes, the late Cyrenius IV, his master's thesis at Harvard University was black colonialism. You can see, you know, my brother called me last night and said, well, Doc, you were here, you fought against so-and-so. Do you think things have changed? I said, my young brother, the simple fact that you're calling me at 11 o'clock in the night and I'm national security advisor shows that you have a sense of dignity and courage. I said, let us talk. It's good. There was a time when representatives were imposed on the people from Barovia. Mm-hmm. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. Today, the people have sent the children to the legislature. Whether they are good or bad, they are the children of the people. Today, anybody can ascend to any position, irrespective of his background, his name.
That's an element of change.
Of course. It's a beginning. You still have to fight against it, but it's a beginning. Are you following me? Today, you sit here, young man, and listen to your music. You are not ashamed to pronounce your name in full. Mamadi Diakesa. There were times in this country when people were even ashamed to call themselves Boima, Boakai, Flumo, Yapao. It was like the Portuguese system of assimilation, where black people would change their identity. Now, most of our people have no identity crisis. They are very proud of who they are. And this is progress. Each time we go for elections, people go and talk to the people in the dialects. So now we're building a nation. We're building a nation. There's no more a little clique. People could think they can recreate that, but it's impossible. History has passed that. So those who come with arrogance have not understood anything of the history of this country. These people have moved. They are not going to look back.
Dr. Boima Fahnbulleh, I am indeed inspired by your comments. And this is the final question.
Just say HB, you know this doctor thing, you people always put titles. That's why all these boys passing around here calling themselves doctors. Just say, the militants called me HB. The brothers would say Boima, okay? And I'm very happy, Boima or HB.
I think you deserve the doctor of
time. Yeah, forget about that. That's all, you know, that's all highfalutin stuff. Degree is a degree, it's a piece of paper. Some people didn't even write a dissertation. They were helped by people.
Wonderful. The final question before we go to the last song, let me just ask like Israel, what are your major concerns and fear for this country?
Oh, I think that we have to make sure that we provide job for our younger people. There are many of them out there. I think we have to embrace our people in the rural areas. We have to invest in infrastructure, in education, etc. The young people in this country, they have the same desires as people all over the world. They want a good life. They want a good life. And the greatest threat to our emerging democracy and our emerging pillars of nation building is this sense of exclusion, where the masses of the people feel they are unemployed, they are rejected, etc. We have to reassure them.
Great, thank you.
And Dad, who do you think will be compared to the efficacy of Nelson Mandela in Africa?
Who will be compared?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, like we said, there's so many people in terms of advocacy right in South Africa I mean, you see the young people. They're agitating, they're talking about economic emancipation. I cannot just zero in on an individual and say, you see, it's difficult to emulate anybody. The context in which Mandela fought was a different context. The context in which Julius Nyerere fought was a completely different context. But people all over Africa, young people, smart people, if they organize the people will write the history tomorrow and say to them, they are great soldiers.
And this leadership deficit you talk about, it's still continuing. How do you think this can be curtailed? The leadership deficit, how do you think it can be addressed?
By educating the people. That's why, you know, the smartest people for any society are young people who are focused, who read, who study. Because if you were to transform these young men and women into nationalists, men and women who have a passion for the country and are proud of the country, they know what their responsibilities are when they grow up. They will be conscious of the responsibility. I was fortunate to have a father who instilled in me the sense of Liberianness, the sense of Pan-Africanism. As a young man, I listened to Mandela's speech, the one at the tribe, at the Rivonia tribe, while I'm prepared to die. I listened to that speech when I was 15 years old. My father had the album. He just listened to it and I was interested. So I think we have a duty to our children and to the young ones to say to them, the house you build is the one in which you're going to live. The country you build, it must be built not for you and your family. It must be built for you and the people.
Your security comes from the fact that the people feel secure in the job, in the welfare, and they build on the hope that the children will succeed tomorrow. I think those are the factors that keep a people united and moving forward.
Okay, what a wonderful way. We thank you very much for coming. This is the True Breakfast Show. I'm going to open the lines. Already my text message and my inbox here registered 79 text messages already.
Yes.
And this is really an intellectual exchange that many persons appreciate. 0777-469-794 is the number to call.
0777-469-793.
Please, we want to take 60 seconds to make a comment very brief. I'll start with this one. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, Mamadi.
Yeah, go ahead.
This is online, Dory. How are you?
Thank you, my brother. Thank you.
Yeah, I must appreciate and thank you for the role play this morning to contrast all that understand the role Matiba or Kappa played in the emancipation of the people of South Africa. But there is this debate of formula that almost 90% of Matiba's argument was centered around South Africa. So there are some critics who argue that he is a new African, but South Africa as a nation.
Okay, now he's not the hero of only South Africa, but Africa as a whole. Okay, I think that's the point. 0777-469-794. I'm going to take 7 calls, then the solo will do the same. Please like, concentrate on the points raised. Good morning. Thank you very much. You made a point. Dad will take note. Later on, he respond. Good morning. Your question, no problem, and I will take note. Four more calls. Good morning.
Pretty fine, my brother. Pretty fine.
Advocacy that can be compared to Mandela. First of all, we've got to identify the advocacy, like you said.
Yeah, but let me take that one quickly. You see, because the question here is that my emphasis has been on the people of South Africa. A great people would produce great noble personalities like Mandela. Anybody in advocacy? We don't believe in the cult of the personality. We don't think in this country any man can stand up and beat his chest and say, I led the Liberian people's struggle. Because this struggle started a long time. That's what I said. How many people have read E.W. Blyden? Blyden and others fought in the 19th century. There were people who came and they advocated. But I can say one thing. All those people who emerged in this, what you call progressive movement, they could only emerge because the Liberian people at the time were ready for change. If the Liberian people were not ready for change, no matter what these people said, no matter what they did, the people would not have moved. I was here. I saw people. Let me just give you a good example. A young brother asked me that people use the rice riot to promote themselves. I said, well, let's assume that it's true. Politicians do that. Was it justified to open fire on unarmed people? Was it justified? No, it was not. You see, the problem here is by 1978-79, the people had started asking questions. And this was because they were listening to the news and foreign developments in Southern Africa. If young children in Soweto who rise up and fight for black dignity, what was happening here? And like the South African ambassador said, Liberia, you have no moral authority to talk. Look at what's happening in your country. This was what people wanted to change. So I am saying here that everybody who stood on the platform, everybody who went into the vanguard, they were put there by the masses of Liberian people who were ready for change.
And no one person can take the credit for
that? No, no, no. That, in fact, that would be too presumptuous, historically presumptuous, that it was because of you. Boima Fahnbulleh played no extraordinary role, except he was a simple, simple cadre, a simple soldier who lived to the dictates of his conscience. So all other brothers must do that. The people out there will write the final history. We are still alive, the struggle is still going on. So why do you want to beat your chest that you did this? Without you, you think the people will not move? And this is what we're talking about, Mandela. Now, the second question, the brother said, Madame Salif's struggle and Mandela's struggle. Two different historical contexts. Madame Salif in Liberia, an independent nation since 1847, that fought a bloody civil war based on tribal allegiance, etc. Mandela in South Africa with a conscious people who had decided to unite to fight against an appalling system of racial discrimination. One thing is interesting. Mandela said, I'm not a saint. Nobody is a saint. Nobody. Human beings have limitations. This is where we have to belong. These young men who are asking these questions, tomorrow, I do hope, they will understand the limitations and promote the values that will lead to unity. I do hope that when they emerge in the vanguard of the people's struggle, they will act differently from many of those they condemn today. Mm-hmm. The brother said, Mandela was for South Africa, he was not for Africa. No, but Dolly, a great revolutionary, embraces humanity. A great revolutionary embraces humanity. He looked for the human worth. Mandela was out of South Africa. Kwame Nkrumah was out of Ghana. Nyerere was out of Tanzania. Amilcar Cabral was out of a little country called Guinea-Bissau. These men were some of the finest sons of Africa. What they said, what they preached, the sacrifices they endured, it was an African struggle. The fact that you and I can make reference to certain people like Lumumba and others. Yes, you, your brother, you are from Liberia. So I am from Liberia. But you really think there are not people in Sierra Leone, Ghana, Nigeria, who have heard about certain people leading certain struggle? They have. Great historical personalities are not those who subscribe to tribalism or clanism or little groups. They are men who embrace the overall aspiration of human advancement. That's what makes them relevant for all time. And probably that is why this personality called Nelson Mandela will be relevant for all times, not only in Africa, but in America, where people had to fight against racial injustice, in Britain, in Canada, in Latin America. These men stood for universal principles.
Okay, a few more calls. Okay. I think we'll have to go a little extra 15 minutes today. Let me just take the balance, the remaining calls. Good morning.
Well, good morning, Jackie. Good morning.
60 seconds, please.
This is Ali Sila, and I come from Front Street this morning. I think that today, you know, in my day, you know, it took me back to my African American study at St. Joseph's University. You know, the adversities of the African struggle, the liberation of black people. You did very, very well analytically driving our foes. I think my question to you is, because we don't celebrate our heroes in Liberia here, what can you say to that? And I think that we stand on many shoulders, what we call the radio station about social justice, academic freedom every day. We stand on many people's shoulders. How can you draw the paradigm of how do we celebrate our local heroes in Liberia?
Okay.
So thank you so much.
Thank you also. Okay, so go ahead. Yes, 0777-4697. Let me take Representative Eugene Falapaka. Good morning.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Representative Waka. Let me take my last call. Good morning.
Talking about, you know, Brother Sila, who said, yes, we stand on the shoulder of giants. And that's very true. You see, I said at the beginning, we must not allow other people to choose our heroes. We must choose our own heroes. And people like Brother Sila and others, a very smart young man, we are happy that he will write a history tomorrow. We are activists and we are soldiers at the front. And we cannot go sit down and promote ourselves or write. Representative Eugene,
and Mandela says it's good to leave from the back.
Also to leave from the front. But Representative Eugene Falapaka, I mean, a young man like that, when you listen to him and you know what he represents, you want to retire. You want to retire. For the simple fact that you realize that others are moving up into the vanguard. Very, very sharp brothers. I mean, you know, to be frank with you, I listen to a lot of criticism. People say a lot of things about me. But you know, I'm satisfied when one or two comrades come out and say, we understand. You see, it is not the numbers we look at, it's the quality. Better, fewer, but better. The Sila, the Eugene Falapaka, the Jefferson Kamu, these brothers, I don't want to call some of the names now because they're strategically placed. But when these brothers speak to you, then you say to yourself, in the closeness of your room, in the closeness of your studies, that we have not done badly.
We have not done that. As a people, as cadres, as elements in the vanguard, and our satisfaction is that tomorrow, those who will write the true and authentic history of our people will give the laurels and give the credit to those who they consider the heroes of the people's struggle. That is, of course, my satisfaction.
What do you think about, what's your point on generational change, young people taking over political authority in Liberia? Final question.
It doesn't matter. You see, Martin Luther King says something, and of course, I believe in the vision of that man. He said, we must look at the content of our character. A young brother said to me one time, HB, what do you think of generational change? I asked him a simple question. What is the difference between a young rogue and an old rogue?
Age.
Well, they're all rogues. If a man does not have character, if he does not have a conscience, it does not matter whether he's young or old. If he develops values that allow him to want to wear a $10,000 suit where people cannot find a cup of rice to eat, that's his value system. And he's going to be corrupt because he doesn't have the means. If you work in public office, he has to pilfer, to steal. If you want to live like a millionaire, go into the private sector. Compete with the Lebanese, make your money, and build your $1 million house. We will come there to enjoy. But when you come in public, the money belongs to the people. The taxes belong to the people. So for me, it is not generation. The change you need is a change of character, of human character. That's all I can say.
Okay, who's your role model?
My role model?
On the continent in the world?
You'd be surprised if I tell you who my role model is. You'd be very, very surprised. I mean, I admire a lot of people. But if you talk about role model, you know, I was saying to a UN official the other day, I passed through Douala. And I saw these market women throwing their lapas on taxes. I said, why are they doing that? They say, oh, it means that the goods are for them.
Yeah.
My role models are these innocent women who sit in the sun the whole day and send the children to very good schools. See the children going to cathedral, convent, other places. See how decent they look. Who you think feeding them? These people who have to deprive themselves. And and that's why I say this country will go forward. Because with our mothers being so courageous. I have a mother who's a very strong woman. In fact, she told me she's the speaker at Elu Graduation. My mother, Mary Brownell, my sister, these are all strong people. When I go to the house, I eat. I don't argue with them. Because, you know, as far as they're concerned, the men will step aside. I say, you people take 90%. Again, it is not a question of gender. It is a question of human character. So role models for me, I will subscribe to the vision of young student militants, to peasants, to ordinary market women, to honest professionals. These people have played such a dynamic role in history. I hope and pray they will not give up the dream of a unified, decent and progressive Liberia.
Are you a Muslim or Christian?
Let me say this, my paternal grandfather, Imam Kwame Tifa, was a Muslim. My father started off as a Muslim, and he died Muslim. My great grandfather was Thomas E. Brunel, or Kipamos, who went into the mountains when he challenged the people who said they were witches. My grandfather, Leticia Brunel, a big Christian, my mother, a big Christian. Where do I stand? Yes, I believe in God. I believe these religions are all very positive. And for me, it does not really matter. I go to church, I go to mosque, we worship the same God. Personally, I do not subscribe to man's interpretation of what God wants. Muslim, Christian, Hindus, they all worship God. The decency of human beings is narrated there by the Quran and by the Bible. Jesus said, on the day of judgment, I say you are saved because I was naked, you clothed me. I was without home, you gave me shelter. I was without food, you fed me. And you say to him, Lord, when did I see thee to do these things unto you? And the Lord will say, insofar as you have done that to your brother, you have done to me.
This is the essence of religion. This is the essence of human, struggle.
What a wonderful way to conclude. Doctor, I'm forced to call that name, Dr. H. Boima Fahnbulleh. Ben Nash talking to you. And it took me tons of time to get you on the radio.
I'm entertained by his comments.
Mamani, you're always traveling to the United States. So it'll be difficult for you to contact. But I thank you, my brother. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We wish you all the best. Okay, this is how we bring down the curtains, inshallah. We're going to be here tomorrow with another show. My name is Mamadi. Stay tuned for the best.
Mamadi, thank you.
Oh,
I'm wrong.